Isaac Newton's Forgotten Invented Language. Isaac Newton laid the foundations of modern science. He discovered gravity and the principles governing motion, light, and cooling. He invented calculus. Most of his work made a huge and lasting contribution to the state of human knowledge, but a few of his projects never made it any further than the paper they were outlined on. All generations that came after him would benefit from his innovations, but none of them would ever use one that he outlined in his student notebooks, his universal language. When Newton was just beginning college, he drew up plans for a language based on the nature of things rather than on mere convention. We call an apple, apple, just out of habit. The form of the word, the sounds in it, don't tell you anything about what it means. Newton's idea was to let the names of the same sort of things begin with the same letter. If, say, all fruits started with A, words wouldn't just be arbitrary labels haphazardly assigned. You could know, just from hearing a word, what category of thing it belonged to. Agnar? Don't know exactly what it is, but it starts with A, so I know it's a fruit. This idea of a universal language where the words express their meaning through an orderly formula was in the air in the 17th century, and Newton was no doubt aware of the efforts that others had already made toward this end. Lots of people had published plans for languages based on symbols, numbers, or letters. Newton's plan was based on letters, and by varying the letters in a word, you could vary its meaning in a predictable way. In Newton's plan, prefixes and suffixes would indicate subtle variations in meaning. His most fully worked out example shows how prefixes could modify the meaning of tor, his word for temperature, to produce more specific meanings from exceedingly hot through pretty hot, warm, indifferently cold, and extremely cold, with all gradations in between. Newton tried to cram an awful lot into this one paradigm, and probably came to understand that if he wanted this degree of precision of meaning for every concept in the world, he would have to devote his life to the task. Instead, he moved on to other things. Another man of science, John Wilkins, a founding member of the Royal Society, did devote his life to the task, and would publish his own 600-page version of this type of universal language several years later. He was celebrated for it at the time. The king thought it was great. But he never used it, and apart from a few of Wilkins's science-minded friends, no one else did either. That language, ingenious but impossible to use, quickly faded into obscurity. In deciding where to focus his energies and talents, Newton chose wisely.